Many people use Midjourney and other AI programs to create graphic stories like comics, graphic novels, and children's books. It's amazing to live in a time when anyone with a story to tell can now create rich visuals, even those without artistic skills. However, AI-powered storytelling is more challenging than it seems, and the available tutorials on YouTube lack depth in this area, which is why this beginner tutorial will focus solely on the features that benefit storytellers. In this video, we'll use Midjourney to create storyboards, design characters, and compose scenes. If you're already familiar with Midjourney, you may skip to the storyboarding section of this video. If you're new, carry on. Head over to the Midjourney website. You may log in with your Discord account. If you don't have Discord, go ahead and create one. Once your Discord and Midjourney account is created, click your account name and manage subscriptions. Midjourney has 4 subscription plans. I always recommend the standard plan for beginners and even for those experienced with other image generators. You can always upgrade later. Click the world icon to go to Midjourney's Discord page. We won't be generating images here. We'll create our own server to keep our assets private. Create my own, for me and friends. Put any name, then get back to Midjourney, and find the Midjourney bot on the right. Select Add to Server, then choose the server you just created. Get back to your server, and now you can create images in peace. Before we generate images, let's get your settings right. Type /settings and hit Enter. Stylize should be medium, remix mode needs to be on, so does high variation mode and fast mode. Now we're good. For us storytellers, we usually need to prompt a subject, a modifier, and an art style. The subject is the main element, while the modifier describes what the subject looks like and what it's doing. The art style is actually part of the modifier, but let's make them separate for now to avoid confusion. Start by typing /imagine. Let's try this prompt. In this case, our subject is man, while holding a sword is the modifier, and 8-bit is the art style. Notice this U and V buttons underneath. I've pre-generated the images for this tutorial to make things easier to teach, which is why you're seeing green and purple buttons, but normally, they're all colored the same unless activated. The numbers here represent the images in the grid. U stands for upscale, which simply enlarges the image. If I click U2, the second grid will be upscaled. V stands for variation, which is exactly what it sounds like. It creates a similar image out of your generation. If I click V1, variations will be created based on the first grid. If you compare the initial grid with the new grid, you can clearly see that the second consists of variants of the same generation derived from the first image. Now going back to the upscaled image, you can see that upscaling introduces new buttons. I want you to ignore the rest for now and focus on vary region. This feature is more commonly known as in painting. And what it does is allow you to change a section of an image instead of generating a new one from scratch. For example, say we want to change the sword here into an axe. You can choose either the square marquee tool to paint over the object that needs changing. But in this case, I think the lasso is easier to use, so I'll just paint all over the sword, making sure that I cover enough areas for the axe. Don't forget to modify the prompt, and then click this. So you see, we now have 4 exact replicas. Save for the section we just in-painted. As a storyteller, you'll be using this feature a lot, especially when Midjourney doesn't generate certain details of your image correctly. Now that you learned the basics, let me show you how to create a simple storyboard. Storyboards serve as visual blueprints to break down the sequence of scenes in a story. This is the formula I use for storyboarding. Storyboards usually come in black and white drawings, but feel free to change the art style if you wish. Okay, this one was close to my vision, but the forest looks barren. What do we do when a generation is close, but not exactly right? Exactly. So now we have 4 variations of that image. Okay, this one does the job, so let's upscale it. Now let's generate the second thumbnail. To make the storyboard consistent, we're gonna use the variation technique. The 4th grid depicts my scene most accurately, so I'll choose that. For the 3rd scene, let's create another variation. Alright, I think this one looks perfect. I think by now you already get the process. The final output looks like this. Okay, so now you know how to create a storyboard with Midjourney. But storyboards aren't the end goal. They are the foundation upon which you build more advanced storytelling workflows. So in a second, I'm going to show you how to design characters and compose a scene. But just very quickly, let me explain aspect ratio because it's quite important. You've probably heard of this term when dealing with screens. It's the ratio between width and height. In Midjourney, it is a parameter denoted as --AR, and we'll be using it for the next workflow. Let's say I'd like to illustrate a medieval fantasy graphic story, whatever, let's keep it vague. I'm gonna create a character reference by typing something like this. And I end up with four variations of my character. Now, if you don't like any of the characters, that's totally fine. You can regenerate another batch by clicking this. But if you want a close variation of one of the generated images, you can click V. In this case, I want another batch of V4 since he's the only one kissed by fire. And I get four new variants. I think I'm fine with this variant, so I'm gonna upscale this. Now, I want you to identify the formula I've used in prompting this character. Soon, you'll have your own character design formula to work with, but for starters, you may use mine. I prompt full body portrait, as sometimes typing portrait often generates only the face and shoulder area, when a torso shot is crucial for creating a character reference. The most important modifier is usually the physical appearance, so place that nearest to the subject, followed by clothing and other details. Modifiers are not limited to these two either. You can input other modifiers like skin color or body structure, etc. Just remember that the sweet spot for prompting is around 15 to 35 words, so you need to prioritize as you can't make it too long, or your words will lose influence. You also have to take into account the art style. In my case, I use a generic one, but there are thousands of art styles out there, and probably millions of iterations of them. The world is your oyster, my friend. I personally like to generate a white background because it's easier to remove. I remove character backgrounds because I like generating them separately. Why? We barely have enough real estate to describe the character properly. If we mix in character and background in one prompt, it's exponentially harder to get the results we've envisioned. And lastly, let's not forget the aspect ratio. I use AR2:3 for the same reason I prompt full body portrait. I want more space for the torso area and part of the legs. I just showed you how to generate a basic character. Now let's make him perform different poses using Midjourney's character reference, denoted as --CREF. Notice how I'm using a variation of the character design formula. Can you spot the changes? Since we'll be using a character reference, I can reduce the description of the appearance and clothing in the prompt. This gives me more room to describe the activity and other useful modifiers. The last step is to add a CREF parameter at the end, then either copying the URL of the reference image or just dragging it into the prompt field. Remember this, parameters in Midjourney just look like this. They're placed at the end of the prompt, and they change how an image is generated. And with this prompt, I got this. Okay, Midjourney wasn't able to accurately depict my prompt. This happens a lot, especially if you're a beginner, but what I can promise you is you'll always find a way to get the results you want. It's all about changing the words and arrangement. You'll get used to it. I don't need this pose anyway, so I won't attempt it again. I do want to generate him trying to shake someone's hand, but this time I'll be more descriptive. I'll use a 3:2 aspect ratio as well, and this is what I got. This one's good, but the image is too dark, I'll choose this one instead. Great. Now obviously, a story usually has more than one character, so I'll generate another one, copying the same art style as everything needs to be consistent. This time, I want to generate a fair maiden. To get the same art style, I need to use the style reference parameter, denoted as --SREF. Then I gotta use an image as reference. You notice that this works very similarly to CREF, but know that you can have multiple reference images. Having more than one style reference helps avoid bias in the pose. Not bad. I'll choose this one. Then I'm gonna generate a new pose of the female character. I wanna make her blush. Then drag the reference image for the character. For the style, I'm using our main character as a reference. This helps create consistency between different characters. Unfortunately, none of these generations have fulfilled my request. I asked for a side view shot, so their heads shouldn't be facing the camera. But as I said earlier, there's always a way. Let's see. I use this image as a reference, and he's looking at the camera. That may be the bias preventing the side view of our maiden. Choosing a side view pose as our reference may solve the problem. Let's try again. Okay, that did it. I think this pose will do, so let me upscale it. Alright, so now we got two character poses. We can now create a scene. Now, I'll take this opportunity to demonstrate two important features for storytellers, pan and zoom. Notice these arrow keys at the bottom. Clicking one of them extends the canvas of your image, allowing you to generate parts not shown in the image. In this instance, the lower half of his body. I'ma click down. By the way, this is normally called outpainting, since we're generating beyond the canvas. Zoom out is another outpainting feature, but instead of generating new regions in one direction, it generates them in all directions at once. You can see the three choices here. 2x means twice the size. Custom zoom allows you to control how much zoom you want. To keep things simple, I'll just use 1.5x. Alright, so this is what we got. Know that you can modify the prompt when using these outpainting features. For example, for this lady, I want to add a negative prompt. A negative prompt is a parameter that tells the AI what to exclude. For example, since there is a pointy object near her buttocks, you can bet that clicking the downward pan will generate a sword. But I don't want a sword. If I type here, she has no sword, then Midjourney will interpret it as put a sword. So what I'll do instead is use the no parameter, denoted by dash dash no, and then put sword here. Now, this indicates that sword is a negative prompt, so hopefully Midjourney will not generate a sword. Unfortunately, it did. The pointy object had too much impact. But I think this one is workable. We could easily remove this later anyway. To be fair, without the negative prompt, the results look like this. The swords are more prominent here and maybe harder to remove, so the negative prompt wasn't entirely useless. With our two full body poses, we can now generate a scene. For that, we need a separate platform for the layout. I recommend three choices. Photoshop is the best in my opinion, and it's what I use now. But a lot of people find it intimidating. It actually isn't hard to learn, but it does cost money. So I also recommend Photopea, which is a clone of Photoshop that's free. Canva is the most user-friendly because it's drag and drop, so I'll be using it for this demonstration. Just go to the Canva website and click Create a Design, then Custom Size. For me, I'll stick to 920 by 1080p. Before I upload our characters on Canva, their backgrounds need to be removed. As mentioned earlier, a white background is much easier to remove. For quick and decent results, I use PhotoRoom, but you can use any online background remover. Now I'm just gonna drag and drop our characters here and lay them out as you see fit. Okay, looks good, but something's missing, isn't it? We need a background. Let's generate one that matches this scene. For backgrounds, I don't need to give you a formula, but I recommend moving the art style at the beginning of the prompt just to ensure that the backdrop matches our art style. On top of that, we'll use dash dash sref. I'm gonna use both characters as a reference. Set the aspect ratio to 16:9, which is the same as my Canva layout. Wait, why are there people here? No, Biki, they can be easily removed on Canva. But I don't like these results, to be honest, they're too dark. So I'm gonna regenerate using the same prompt. Only this time, I'm gonna use the stylize parameter denoted as dash dash s. What does stylize do? It makes your generations more artistic. Now, why didn't I use this parameter when designing our characters? Stylize also makes your prompt less accurate in favor of artistry, and characters are harder to get right. By default, your stylized value is 100, but you can set it between 0 to 1000 in the prompt. For this example, I'll try the stylized values of 350 and 500 respectively. Let's see what they look like. And boom, they do look better now. For me, this one looks best, so I'll upscale it. But I do think it's too small for a backdrop, so let's expand using zoom. This one's good, but the castle is too centered, so I'm gonna pan right. Perfect. Now let's upload it to Canva and remove the extra figure. Okay, it looks a little odd because the lighting doesn't match and the background and foreground don't have enough contrast. What we're gonna do here is darken the characters first. And then we're gonna brighten the background as well. You can also adjust the temperature. The right side makes it look warmer. Honestly guys, I'm still a beginner at color grading, that's why it's not so good. But I will keep learning and so can you. For now, this is good enough. Now I said earlier that there are millions of possible art styles, but unless you're an art major, it can be difficult to determine the right words to prompt a style that fits your story, while being unique enough to give it justice. One way to get around this is to use Google Images to find artworks that you like, then use sref to reference it. But this is a slippery slope because unless you're only using images in the public domain, this is considered plagiarism, especially if the artist is alive. If you do reference multiple artists, that may be a gray area and you might get away with it, but I actually have a better way. This subtle approach allows you to generate hundreds to thousands of art style variations without referencing a single artist. But before I give it away, there's something that I need to say. Many people have found success in using Midjourney for their stories, but not all of them are willing to share their workflows. In fact, most of them don't. This is why I've made it my mission to always share my discoveries, and since no man is an island, I created a Discord community for all of us storytellers to support each other and potentially collaborate. You might want to check it out, links in the description. To generate multiple art styles, you can use the style tuner. Simply type /tune and then type the prompt. In my case, I'll be recycling my knight character. Hit enter, and now you can choose how many style directions. The higher the number, the more permutations of different art styles you can combine. In this example, I'm gonna go with 16 style directions because I don't wanna waste credits. Once you submit, just wait for a minute or two and your style tuner should be ready. Click on the link, which will direct you to the style tuner page. Now you can choose from multiple art styles. You can reference just one style individually or combine multiple, up to you. Remember, this is the lowest number that I've chosen. Imagine how many permutations you can make if you selected 128 pairs. Now to select a style, just click on them, then copy the style code at the bottom. I'm just gonna copy the prompt I used earlier and add two parameters. The style parameter denoted by --style or --s, and then copy paste the code from the tuner. The other parameter is --v space 5.2. Side note, V stands for version. 5.2 was the previous version before the latest. Version 5.2 had an experimental feature called Style Tuner, but it's no longer available in the latest model. However, I have a method to still use it. What was the style code again? Alright, we copied the art style. I like this one best. Now what we're gonna do here is use this image as a style and character reference to generate new poses. To make things fast, I'll just use the pose of him flaunting his sword. Now what we'll do is use C-Ref and S-Ref so we can copy the art style in the latest version. And now we got this! Note that the artwork will be a little off because they are different versions of Midjourney after all. Now what if I reference this art style instead? I got this. If I choose this happy art style, I get a happy knight. And if you combine art styles, the sky is the limit. Now I want to set realistic expectations. Patience is essential when using AI image generation for storytelling. The images I've shown for the demonstrations were not exactly haphazardly chosen, but a lot of them were terrible on the first attempt. Most required 2 to 3 tries to get right for demonstration. Sometimes it can be difficult to convey your vision to Midjourney. But what I promise you is this, there is always a way. You just gotta be persistent and keep learning. I'll see you next time.